Welcome back, geology fans. Walking to the west and into the past here at the top of Red Rocks Park, there is no doubt where the oldest contact is on the far west side of the parking lot, as it is a sharp contact, not at all gradational. This sharp contact lays between crystalline rocks on the right and the tilted sedimentary rocks we were in on our left. We can tell from superposition that the crystalline rock is older, and so we begin our close-up investigation there. This formation is known as the Idaho Springs Formation, and we see that it does not have layers, but is fractured throughout with structural joints. The dominant color appears to be a ruddy red, though we do see some folded light and dark banding, which might suggest a metamorphic gneiss. We also see a break in the red, where freshly broken surfaces appear. This dominant red is really only a surface coating of rust, known to geologists as the iron oxide mineral hematite. Geologists carry hammers because, well, rocks are like children. They lie. So we beat them. And once we break through the false weathering rind of rock, we can see its true nature within. The Idaho Springs Formation's true inner nature is tightly packed crystals showing foliation. Our hunch that this is a metamorphic gneiss has been confirmed. There are gray crystals of quartz and pink potassium feldspar, but there are a lot of black crystals in there that turn out to be plate-shaped, dark mica, which we know as biotite. Now, biotite is a bit higher on Bowen's reaction series, and so is a little bit less chemically stable at the surface. And as it breaks down, some components go into solution, some into clays, and the iron, exposed to oxygen, becomes our red friend, hematite. The rust coating on the Idaho Springs gneiss came from the weathering of the biotite in the gneiss itself. We know that gneiss is made deep underground, and so the fact that it is here at the surface should trigger two words in our heads: uplift and erosion. From great depths, these rocks were uplifted and all their massive overburden stripped away, but their journey is greater than that. Radiometric dating indicates these rocks are 1.7 billion years old, which places them in the Statherian period of the Paleoproterozoic era. This formation's overall chemistry has a rather funny feature that says that this rock did not start out as a granite because it has too much calcium and carbon included, and yet has much of the rest of the aluminosilicate chemistry of an igneous nature. So we go looking around the planet today, and we try to find places that are depositing this kind of chemistry of a lot of carbon, a lot of calcium, and the aluminosilicate chemistry of an igneous nature. And, you know, one of the best examples is the Sea of Japan. There, in a deep ocean trench behind an island arc of volcanoes, we get the slow deposition of limestone. Maybe a little bit of clays, silts. Now, the limestone's made of calcium carbonate, which gives us our calcium and our carbon. And then you get these periodic injections of volcanic ash with the aluminosilicate chemistry that we see as well. All the evidence suggests that we were in such a back arc trench when the Idaho Springs Formation was being deposited. In filling out your chart in the lab book, this is Site 1, and this is Rock Formation 1A. So 1A is the Idaho Springs gneiss. It is 1.7 billion years old. It does not have a grain size, but it is to be marked as recrystallized. The minerals are quartz, potassium feldspar, biotite, and hematite staining. The environment of deposition is a subduction zone in a back arc basin like the Sea of Japan. Once the Sea of Japan subduction zone closes up, it will suture the islands of Japan to the eastern shore of Asia, growing it outward. This allows us to see the event this rock location represents. It is the formation of an ancient supercontinent called Columbia, which began to piece together the land masses of the world 1.8 billion years ago, or about 100 million years before these particular rocks were deposited. Though it was dirty limestone that was the parent rock of this formation about 1.72 billion years ago, That limestone was later subducted to a depth allowing gneissic metamorphism, and it appears that this took place about 1.4 billion years ago. But we see no evidence of melting, so once the volcanic islands of the past sutured onto the side of Columbia, the subduction events ceased and left our formation solid, though deep enough to metamorphose to gneiss. But we have also said that it must have been uplifted and its overburden eroded away. An obvious question is when and how that happened, which we will look at in the next episode.